What are the odds that a no-name 18th century Presbyterian minister held the key to making artificial intelligence a reality? While Ben Franklin is running around flying kites, Thomas Bayes is figuring out how to make educated mathematical guesses in situations where you don't have that much to go on, like possibly the probability that this guy exists. But then Bayes dies before he's had a chance to tell anyone what he's been up to. Soon after, his philosopher buddy, Richard Price, discovers Bayes' notebooks while digging around his apartment looking for free swag. Price is a pretty smart guy, so he instantly recognizes the genius of his pal's theory. In 1763, he cleans up the math and publishes it in an obscure journal before using it to revolutionize the insurance business, where they need probabilities to figure out how much to rip you off by. Fast forward to 1812. While the US and England are at it again, a French guy named Pierre-Simon Laplace develops Bayes' theory into something more usable, which becomes known as conditional probability. It lets you update your guesses with any new facts that might come your way. Like this. Say the probability of getting dengue fever while visiting Bermuda for a week is 1 in 10,000, or 0.01%. I'm totally making this up. You go to Bermuda, come home, and to be safe, take a test that is 99.9% accurate in detecting the virus. Your test comes back positive. You start to freak out, saying goodbye to loved ones, writing out your will, and are about to adopt a new religion when you take a second Bayesian look at the results. Remember, for every one person with the virus, there are 9,999 people without it, which means that even a robot programmed to always spit out a negative test result, regardless of who's taking the test, would still guess correctly 99.99% of the time. Being accurate 99.9% of the time, then, isn't really that impressive. What you really need to figure out is how accurate that test is when it spits out a positive result. When this one person with the virus takes a test, chances are 99.9% that it'll be accurate. Out of the 9,999 people without the virus taking the test, 99.9% of them will get an accurate test result, which translates to 9,989 people. That means that the remaining 10 people will be inaccurately diagnosed, testing positive for dengue fever when they don't actually have it. So, out of the 11 people testing positive for the dengue virus, only one of them actually has it. Meaning, the chances your positive test result is right is only 1 in 11, or 9%, not 99.9%. Now swap dengue fever with HIV, and you're looking at an actual, real-life example people have found themselves in. Conditional probability works pretty well, and can literally save your life. But the big thinkers of the day aren't impressed with the phrase, works pretty well. They're all about frequentist probability, a more popular approach that claims that the only way you can really know the odds is to have lots of hard, objective data that backs you up. Let's say you flip a coin once and it lands heads. Based on that, you might assume it's always gonna land heads, but that'd be pretty stupid. We all know that the more times you flip a coin, the closer it's gonna get to landing heads just half the time. That's the whole point of frequentist probability. Flip that coin enough times and you'll have good enough data to take on Vegas. To those guys, Bayesian probability is like shooting an arrow half blindfolded and hoping you hit the target. But most of the time, that's exactly where you find yourself, needing an answer without having much to go on. That's why World War II hero Alan Turing, that nerdy British guy who dreamed of computers way before Steve Jobs did, used Bayesian probability to crack top-secret transmissions, some of them sent from Der Führer himself. Despite this, the frequentists still think Bayesians are lame, and the rivalry continues deep into the 20th century. But then, the 1980s. People had been trying to make artificial intelligence a reality since the 60s, programming computers with basic logic like, if X is true, then Y happens. That approach works fine as long as X is always true, but as you can guess, there are too many unknown variables in the real world to bring C-3PO to life. But then, in 1988, Jadea Pearl jumpstarts AI with a new approach based on, you guessed it, Bayes' theory. So that's why in 2011, when a computer called Watson beat a couple of humans answering questions on Jeopardy, it was Thomas Bayes running around inside Watson's brain going, if this is true, then that might be true. And if that other thing is true, then I'm gonna buzz in with, what is Chicago, Alex? 250 years after he flipped his last coin, it turns out, Bayes' odds were pretty damn good.